Welcome to Space News from the Electric Universe, brought to you by the Thunderbolts Project at thunderbolts.info. In part one of this presentation, physicist Wal Thornhill introduced evidence for the extraordinary recent origins of our planetary neighbor Venus. In myth and folklore around the entire globe, Venus was remembered as the Great Comet, as a dragon-like serpent breathing fire about the heavens, and as a goddess with majestic, flowing hair. As noted previously, based on Venus's mythic identity, Dr. Immanuel Velikovsky was the only individual to correctly predict that Venus would be super hot. An even more outrageous prediction by Velikovsky was that the planet Saturn was a source of water in Earth's oceans. As we reported in 2018, this prediction received astonishing support when scientists wrote in the journal Icarus that water in Saturn's rings and satellites is remarkably like water on Earth. We asked Wal to continue to explain his own reconstruction of our solar system's recent catastrophic history, and to reflect on the significance of recent science discoveries on this reconstruction.
First, I think I need to give a warning. The Electric Universe identifies fundamental errors in science which have held back progress for more than a century, so what follows is entirely off the map of accepted science today. I mentioned earlier that we were a satellite of a brown dwarf star, Proto-Saturn, so the answer to Velikovsky's prediction of Saturnian water on Earth requires a fundamental rethink about both nuclear physics and the century-old model of what stars are. Stars are not controlled thermonuclear explosions. Their steady light signals a simple, controlled process. The Electric Universe model of stars was verified experimentally in 2019 by the Sapphire Project and proved stable and controllable. It proved that most of the Sun's radiant energy comes from the transmutation of light elements in the bright photosphere, right in front of our eyes. Power like the Sun by thermonuclear fusion has been a colossally expensive pipe dream. It demonstrates the tunnel vision of experts. As for particle physics, a number of leading researchers have declared the standard particle model is in crisis. But the Titanic steams on, ignoring the low-energy nuclear icebergs that are being produced in laboratories now. Brown dwarfs are low-energy electric stars inside a bloated red anode glowing shell. To give some idea, if Jupiter's magnetosphere were to be lit up, it would appear at opposition the size of the full moon in our sky. Jupiter's large moons would orbit inside that glowing red sheath. Inside that huge bubble is the most hospitable environment for life because the radiant energy received by each satellite is evenly distributed over its entire globe. There are no seasons, no tropics, and no ice caps. The radiant energy from the plasma sheath of a brown dwarf star is strongest at the blue and red ends of the spectrum. L-type brown dwarfs have water as a dominant molecule in their spectra, along with many other biologically important molecules and elements. Satellites, like the Earth, would accumulate atmospheres from such a brown dwarf, and water would mist down continually. Regardless of its spin and axial tilt, a satellite orbiting inside the plasma sheath of a brown dwarf could experience an ideal environment for life. However, the brown dwarf Garden of Eden comes with a caveat. Stars off the main sequence, without a bright photosphere, do not have the self-regulating photospheric discharge to smooth out variations in electrical power input. Consequently, brown dwarfs are subject to sudden outbursts or flaring when they encounter a surge in the circuit that powers them. These flares will dump minerals and gases on the satellites orbiting inside the sheath. It sculpts their surfaces electrically and causes sudden extinction events, vast fallout deposits, and instant electrical fossilization. The last dramatic flaring event, Let There Be Light, signaled the breakup of the Proto-Saturnian system and traumatized our prehistoric ancestors, giving rise to all of our creation myths and existential post-traumatic stress disorder. It was that dying gasp of proto-Saturn that gave rise to a stream of material orbiting Saturn. Described as the Ouroboros, or snake swallowing its tail, the matter piled up to form the radiant planet Venus. Saturn's icy rings are the bright remnant of that matter. The Earth, being a much older satellite of proto-Saturn, explains the origin of our amazing abundance of water, and likely its saltiness, according to Velikovsky. Nitrogen on Earth and Titan are predominant in their atmospheres. This suggests very strongly that the natal atmosphere of Venus contained a lot of nitrogen. So why is Venus's atmosphere today predominantly carbon dioxide? The answer comes from the nitrogen being consumed at the surface and converted to carbon monoxide. This reaction was observed by the leading French scientist Louis Kervran when he found welders being poisoned with carbon monoxide, yet there was none in the air. He found that the red-hot surface of iron that they were welding was energizing the nitrogen molecules, which were then breathed in, and on the substrate of the lung was converted, the energy was converted to carbon monoxide. In other words, the nitrogen molecule, the nitrogen nuclei, joined to become two different nuclei, carbon and oxygen. Two nitrogen gives carbon and oxygen. So this was demonstrated experimentally by Professor Louis Kervran. So now we have on the surface of Venus carbon monoxide being formed from the nitrogen. On Venus, the high surface temperature and the water in the atmosphere, remembering that we must have had a considerable amount of water also in the atmosphere, come together in a well-known industrial reaction to form carbon dioxide and hydrogen. The lighter hydrogen is being lost and has been detected in space. Now, to confirm this model, the early Venus landers discovered that water vapor was present in the atmosphere but decreased strangely on approach to the surface. This fits the suggested model. But most importantly, the latest discovery of the decrease in nitrogen as we approach the surface of Venus offers further support, because there we have the welder's hot surface energizing the nitrogen and converting it into carbon and oxygen, or carbon monoxide. Earlier, I mentioned the entire planet is said to have been resurfaced by some unknown process. The far simpler explanation that Venus is an infant simply doesn't occur. As for the network of filamentary scars, they encircle the planet in the low latitudes. Venus was remembered by the ancients as a radiant star. The reconstruction of events show Venus with a variable number of distinct streamers radiating outwards like the petals of a cosmic flower. This pattern is seen looking down the barrel of certain plasma discharge experiments here on Earth. The filamentary pattern around the equator of Venus is to be expected under these conditions, since an electrical discharge in the very dense atmosphere of Venus will switch from being diffuse in space to becoming very narrow lightning channels under these conditions. The extreme energy of the cosmic lightning is sufficient to sculpt the arachnoid features and bizarre pancake domes. In the case of Titan, I propose that it was also a relatively young satellite of our brown dwarf. I wrote in 2004 that Titan may be young as hinted at by its eccentric orbit, which cannot have persisted for billions of years. Like Venus, surface temperatures are globally uniform on Titan within a few degrees. It is thought that there is a greenhouse effect operating on Titan. However, the heat of Venus is due to its origin and has nothing to do with the greenhouse effect. The same will likely be true for Titan. Like Venus, Titan seems not to have a magnetic field, and yet it has a distinct magnetotail. Titan's electrical plasma interactions may be like those of Venus. Titan also shines on the day side in ultraviolet light too brightly to be explained by solar radiation. To sum up, the best possible indication we could have that our reconstruction of events is real and accurate is the novelty and specificity of our successful predictions. Having a good model allows better questions and experiments in future, It allows us to halt the terrible waste today in education, manpower, and massive public funds on misguided experiments, on big science. The electric universe is inspiring participation by the public, by garage experimenters who are reproducing features on planetary surfaces using electric discharges. Science is a cultural activity and should be open to all to participate. The modern cult of the narrowly trained expert must end. The world is far more complex than any of our pet theories can deal with. Only the broadest perspective can reveal the interconnectedness of our electric universe and guide us to the science of the future.